Chris Swanton. Brady Stewart covering Drayton. Stewart forces the ball up high to Buck. Buck gets the screen from Bernier, but it's a one on three and he gets through. Slippery move by Buck. And he keeps the ball up to Houghton. Houghton over to Buck. Buck not a big guy, but he doesn't get pushed around and he seems to be able to slip through those screens. Quentin Schneider wins the physical battle for it in the corner and flips it up to his teammate. Houghton forced back to the center, late in the shot clock, Gaten dumps it in the corner. But every 30 seconds it goes off the clock, gets Orangeville closer to a win. Now lots of time left, but... Mike Feegan set up on the left, I'd call it kind of the hash marks almost. There's McElmoy with a slick move, plays it up to Elder. Elder dinks into the dotted line, can't go anywhere. Old tries a little flip to McElmoy, but just out of the reach of his stick to the goalie. Jamie Hunt playing the ball on defense. Hunt played it over to 14, who is Alex Beekman. We heard his name a lot early, but haven't really heard from him for a while. Now McElmoy playing aggressively and change of possession back to Orangeville. Back in the offensive end. Liam Smith battling there, setting screens for everybody. And there's Houghton with a shot. No goal.
Boom.
Oh, Truck can't get away. Looked like it may be a bit of interference, but deemed a good play by the ref. Now this number 20, Quentin Schneider.
And it's 4-on-1.
He is a big specimen. I'm not sure how many races he's winning, but in a physical battle like that, they could get the ball.
No, exactly.
And Quentin Maddock is much the same. He moved down the floor well, but he wants to engage in some physical play and beat you up. He just hasn't had that opportunity tonight. Here's Luke Grimaldi, who tries a flip pass, but I'll use the term again, their wires were crossed. Look at the hustle back by Mike Feegan. And on the ball now is the captain, Dan Kitto. Run right back up. Comes right through the middle. He's going to hand off to Quentin Maddock.
Minor penalties are done.
Laverne back on the floor. And you know what they say, Andrew Laverne? Keep yourself on the floor there, sir. He has been noticeable tonight and scored a nice goal. Grimaldi can't handle that hot pass just down at his knees, but Maddock gets it back. Here's what I'm talking about, his big physical strength. He comes across, tries a little backhand shovel, but doesn't find the net. 5.5 left, 9-4 Orangeville. So in the last 5.5 minutes for Owen Sound, what are the coaches going to be saying here? What's the point of the next 5.5 minutes?
That's just basically close shift by shift. And just think what you got to do for the next game or practice. If you're going to practice hard, you got to play hard. But if maybe that last couple of practices has... Curtis Gibbons was saying, guys, we've got to think about what we're doing. And I'm sure it's as frustrating to them because they can't get out the floor and do it themselves.
Yeah, yes.
I only remember too well. This is a player and a kid both.
Yeah. But you're right about that from the coaching standpoint. As much as you want to, you can't strap on your running shoes and go do it for them. I think, guys, it's not a long season.
Junior Cross is not a long season, so
they can't waste opportunities.
No.
Mike Feegan working hard this shift, 1-on-2, loses the end of the shot clock. Swanton has to give it back to Orangeville. Get freed up. Now he does. Now across the top. Oh, not quite to Andrew Laverne. Here's that stretch pass we talked about from the goalie, but not being able to go up the middle, that might have changed his thinking, so it does not connect. Because if Drake got that, there's no catching him. Here comes John Frook, plays the ball to Quentin Maddock, who looked fairly dangerous last shift. Started to use his strength and his smarts and lifted a little move toward the net. Here's McElmoy, a doe, slides out the end of his stick, checked as he's about to shoot it.
Exactly.
And I like about Orangeville's approach is they're not just sitting back and waiting. They're going after it still.
Yeah, that Vladek must have taken one right off there. I mean, he's holding that left shoulder, and that's exactly where the puck always going to release high. He had it going down. But
Searle with a nice pass over to Snyder, but a good save by Hamilton. A little bit of extra slashing going on here between the players, so we'll just see if the referees can keep a lid on the ball.
2 minutes and 40 seconds to go in the third period.
I always think when it gets kind of silly physical at this time, I'm not saying this game will, but at these times, it's a bit wasted. It's a bit
exactly.
Too late.
Yeah.
If you're going to have a physical response, it's got to be not 9-4, 2.5 left.
Exactly.
I'm not suggesting that to someone sound as pink, but... You know, we've been in these types of games before in different sports. The teams push back way too late. So here's Searle with the ball. Searle moves it over to Ditherbide. There's usually one name per team I just get stuck with. Ditherbide. Number 11. Blocked there by Alex Bean. Oh, a little slippery out there on the cement right at the moment. Changing humidity levels will cause a bit of a sweat on the concrete floor. Here's Orangeville with a minute eight left. 9:40 lead. There's going to run out their shot clock, and they get a shot great. That's a nice job by Buck over there.
Just tell him, guys, hey, guys, just cool it, go to the bench.
Yeah, why bother?
Exactly.
And that's what you mentioned in the intermission and at different times, that sort of leadership that a Buck and a Cameron Spencer provide for this team. They've been through the wars.
Yep.
So as we go through this season with the Owen Sound Junior B North Stars, Orangeville just letting it run out. 5 seconds shot clock, 20 seconds in the game. This is it. I'm thinking it will be a 9-4 victory for Orangeville.
Exactly.
You know, number 17, Colin Kittem. Oh, we might see a penalty coming out.
Yeah, there's definitely a penalty there.
Devin McLean took one right in the guts there.
Yeah.
I think they gave a 4 minute. Oh, sorry, 5 minutes.
In the 5 minute, how are you?
Yeah. And I know Colin pretty well from Owen Sound District Secondary School and volleyball, and that he's not an unreasonable character.
Yeah.
So that just shows you the level of frustration that Owen Sound has
pure
to
frustration.
Finish off a 9-4 loss.
Exactly.
I'm sure the message coming in was, hey guys, 6-5 in their building, let's put a win or loss on them in our building.
Yeah, exactly.
So what did we learn about Orangeville tonight, Steve?
Orangeville's got a good balance club from the goaltender right through their whole offense, and that's evident as we've seen here tonight. You've got some senior high guys, and I'm not knowing the birthdays of these kids. Hamilton, you can look at the leadership of Daniel Tanner, Tanner Buck, and Cameron Spencer. You look at a kid like Brett Drake. The scoring ability that those kids have, or just the overall skill set, period. Not many guys want to shake hands here.
It looked like the teams wanted to shake hands, but the referees maybe were thinking it might not go that well. But
exactly.
Again, these guys, one of the things that drives me absolutely bananas about hockey is that they shake hands before the game.
Oh,
to me, that's sending the wrong message.
Exactly.
You need to send the message that at the end of the game, it's over.
Yeah.
So I like Logan Swanton, a leader for Owen Sound and Tanner Buck, of course, a leader for Orangeville, that out there shake hands, say, hey, we'll see you again, I'm sure. And we're going to get an opportunity to talk a bit more, Steve. Cameron Glover looks like he's going to interview number 27, Dan Kittle, when we come back here from a break. So join us after the break right here on Rogers TV.
Welcome back to the Nature. I'm here with North Stars captain Dan Kittle. Dan, 9-4 loss tonight. Tell me your feelings right now.
I feel like we could have worked a little harder, maybe dug a little deeper in the corners. A few more loose balls, just played our man a little better, just a little more structure.
And where do you think they beat you guys through the whole game?
I say their transition definitely ran up a few goals, and just they got out in our hands, not let us get shots, and they got some shots from the outside that went in. So
now I talked to Kurt last period about this. losing some key guys from last year. What do you do to fill those holes?
I just mean a few guys. Some of the younger guys got to work harder. That's basically it. Just other people have to fill the same roles. We can't play any less.
What's it like playing with your brother this year?
It's good. It's good. We played a few games together last year, but it's good being teammates with him.
And tell me your reaction when you found out you're going to be captain of the team this year.
I was ecstatic. I wasn't really expecting it, so it was a nice surprise, and it feels good.
All right. Thanks, Dan, for your take on the game tonight. We're going to go to break, and we'll be back with more with Steve and Michael.
Each week on Rogers Channel 53.
Sure, tough 9-4 loss for the North Stars tonight. Put them at 1-4 on the season. We'll now go to Michael and Steve on their take of tonight's game.
Thanks, Cam. And I thought another great job interviewing a player that obviously is a bit dejected after a game like that. Dan Kiddo, the captain, he talked about being ecstatic when he was named the captain. So he wants that leadership and he wants that role placed upon him. So I know he won't be happy with the performance they put in tonight.
No, that's right.
How tough would that be in Dan Kiddo's spot to do that interview and kind of put on the brave face, I'll say?
He's been around the club a few years now.
Yeah.
And he's got a younger brother. He's trying to say, guys, we got to lead by example, and we didn't set a very good example ourselves tonight on the floor. Yeah, we played against a good ball club out there.
Yeah.
But we've got to think about this. They're the defending champions.
Yeah.
But we've also got to make ourselves better in this league too. Only got one victory so far. They've got to, when they have the opportunity against teams of equal or lesser strength,
yes,
they've got to remember to be on their best game.
Well, and it's interesting you mention that, because coming up, their opponent on May 17th, it will be the Guelph Regals. And the Guelph, they're at 2-3 with a losing record as well. We just had, what day are we today? We're May 5th.
They get to go to the...
Where are we today? May 3rd.
They're going to
run. So we've got some away games, four away games in a row.
Yeah.
And then May 17th, we see them in Guelph. So they've got Guelph twice.
You
got
to look at those road trip games there at Wallaceburg Point Edward this coming weekend in Guelph at the 11th.
TV, when we do our sports exclusive broadcast, that's your next opportunity
exactly
to watch the Junior B team. You're going to have some senior lacrosse coming up too. We talked about that. Now, we mentioned off the top that Rodney Tapp, the head coach, isn't around. He's other coaching duties down. I think he's still away with the college team. He coaches
exactly,
in the United States. When he gets back, what does his experience and his knowledge, and believe me, I'm not knocking the people that were there, but what can that add to the team?
Well, it only proves that he's got a higher coaching level, older guys, because they're all university kids. So he's got that mature kids that he's dealing with right now. He's coming back to a group of younger players for sure.
Just that age group.
And he's going to develop again from, he's going to put on a new headset to get that group going. But he's got two good guys on the bench with him that are both still want to play the game in being representing the senior team here in town. It's a great mix of all three guys is what I can see.
Yeah.
Not knowing them, but hey, let's think about the game.
Yeah, and if you look at their experience levels and their playing levels, there's certainly no shortage of knowledge on that bench. And Brock Feltz is the other one that's on the bench. You saw him across the way with the white hat on. Happened to speak with him on the sidewalk, and he's really excited with this group and what they can build into as a team.
Exactly. The kids got to be sponges to guys like that. And
thank you, Michael. Thank you, Steve. Yes, May 17th is our next game here on Rogers TV at the Bayshore. Be sure to tune in then. And for myself, Michael, Steve, and everyone in the booth, have a great night and see you May 17th.
Mike, number 26, Rome, Thomas, Dustin, Lance, number 6.
Trevor Castle.
Oh, sorry, 16, yep, Trevor Castle. And Dustin Lance doing well here.
Exactly.
He got the helmet off early.
Pull her over.